This is the National Science Olympiad Astronomy C presentation, which is meant to be a sort of coach's clinic to give an overview of the content for the teams to prepare for the 2014 competition in Orlando, and for the coaches to help their teams know where to locate and acquire the resources that are necessary to prepare for competition, and also for any event supervisors for regional or state competitions to have an idea of the content, the materials that they need to prepare their individual events for the 2014 competition. The focus this year the focus for the 2014 astronomy event is stellar evolution and variable stars. I am Donna Young. As you know, I am the National Event Supervisor for Astronomy, and I have a co-event supervisor, Tad Komasik, who is now in a doctoral program in geophysics and planetary science in Tucson, Arizona, at Arizona University. We both of us co-develop the event. And if you have any questions that you need answered, you can email either one of us, unless it is specific to the event description, and then you will need to do that through the National Science Olympiad that I'll talk about in later on in the presentation. So this event has been supported by the Chandra X-ray Observatory since it became an event in 1999. And this webinar will be posted on this site when all is said and done. Some of the deep sky objects we'll be talking about are on this website, and some stellar evolution materials to help you learn about stellar evolution in the HR diagram are on this site. This competition is also supported by the American Association of Variable Star Observers, also located in Cambridge, Massachusetts, just down the road a little bit from the Chandra X-ray Center. On the AABSO website, if you go to Variable Stars down to Educational Materials and over to Science Olympiad, that is where we post the events. So the astronomy event from the past three years, I do believe, are now posted on the AABSO website, so you can download those and use them to study and prepare for the 2014 competition. They also have an entire curriculum posted here called Variable Star Astronomy, and also the HR diagram plotting activity, which you should do to prepare for the 2014 event. That would be very beneficial if you did that. And some of the deep sky objects in this year's event are located on the AABSO website in their Variable Star of the Season archive. So, this year's event, stellar evolution and variable stars. So the only difference is the variable star part. There is no difference in what you need to bring for the competition. Each team is still allowed either to bring two laptops or two three-ring binders, or one laptop and one three-ring binder. We get questions every now and then from students wondering if they can bring an iPad or a tablet. We don't care. Any electronic device that you want to substitute for a laptop is fine, understanding there is no internet access, not that that would help you, even if there was, I promise you that. All of the tablet, the iPad, the laptop is just an electronic three-ring binder anyway. So, the words in red here is the content that's new this year that's different from last year. But if you have been doing this competition for the past 2 years, you will see that what's new this year was on the part of this event in 2012. Because in 2012, we had stellar evolution and type 1a supernovas. This particular year, it's stellar evolution and type 2 supernovas. In 2014, stellar evolution and variable stars. So a lot of the stellar evolution stages, in fact, all of them have been covered. last year and this year, and some of the variable stars were covered either in one of those 2 years. So a lot of these new words on here are really stuff that you already know if you've been doing this for a couple of years. So the one thing that I would say is this. Because we're dealing this year specifically with variable stars, and so we're using two or three different categories that you probably have not seen before, because this year we are really emphasizing the transitional regions on the HR diagram. We are looking at those, the transitional stages from one stellar evolution stage to another stellar evolution stage. The transitional, so look at the HR diagram transitional regions, the regions of instability. That's the major focus of this year's competition. This is a very gross cartoon of some of the major classes of variable stars. The general catalog of variable stars has a few hundred classes and subclasses. The ones of particular interest to us for 2014 competition, two categories of intrinsic variable stars, the ones that are varying in their brightness because of instabilities within the stellar atmosphere or within the stellar core. We have two major groups, the pulsators and the cataclysmic variables. In the pulsating stars, we have three major categories, the Cepheids, the RR Lyraes, and the long period variables. There are two types of long period variables, the Miras and the semi-regulars. So those are all on the 2014 event, along with three of the different types of cataclysmic variables. Supernovas, of course, which you're familiar with by now, recurrent novas and dwarf novas. Also, there is one more group, the eruptive ones. The T Tauri stars and the S Doradus are the two groups or classes of eruptive stars that are on the 2014 event as well. These are the deep sky objects for this next competition. You will see that there are a variety. We have two pulsators. One is a Mira, which is a Mira variable star, and V1, which is a Cepheid variable star. Those are both pulsating stars. And then for the eruptives, we have T Tauri and Ori 1647, which is another T Tauri variable star. And we have Eta Carina, which is a very different type of variable star from T Tauri's. And that, we will talk about that in more detail as we go along. It's an S Doradus variable star, and it also is classified as a blue luminous variable star, an LBV, luminous blue variable. We have six different cataclysmic variables this year, two type 2 supernovas, two type 1A supernova events, and we have a dwarf nova and a recurrent nova. We'll go through these particular ones in as we go along. We have one X-ray binary. We have a two white dwarf binary system, we have two planetary nebulas, and we have two globular clusters and one Sirius star formation region, the trapezium. So, Mira is not only an example of a Mira variable star, it is the prototype of all Mira variable stars. It is a pulsator. It is in the red giant stage, a stage that stars go through that leave the main sequence. When they run out of hydrogen, they stop hydrogen fusion in their core, they leave the main sequence, they transcend up to the red giant branch. During that time, they go through a region where they become unstable and they pulsate. Mira, in particular, is very interesting. This image here is from the Galax mission. It's an ultraviolet image that shows that as it moves through space-time under its own proper motions, it shows all the debris that it ejected from the surface during those pulsations. And this is a Chandra X-ray image and an artist illustration of the observational data that shows that Mira not only is a variable star, but it has a white dwarf companion. And it's actually accreting material in an accretion disk around that white dwarf from Mira. So at some particular point in time, if there is some dump of material from the accretion disk onto the surface of the white dwarf, we might have some kind of a nova situation, which is another type of variable star. Or if it accretes enough mass that it approaches Chandrasekhar's limit and no longer can exist as a white dwarf, we might have a type 1a supernova event in the future. V1 is a Cepheid variable that's in the Andromeda galaxy. This is a Hubble image showing the part of the range in magnitude change or brightness change of V1. This is actually the variable star that sort of made the universe into a very large place. This is the one that Edwin Hubble, when he discovered the period of this Cepheid variable star and determined the distance and discovered it was in a galaxy far, far away, then they knew that those little smudges in space-time were not just nebulae within the Milky Way galaxy, but other galaxies. Two globular clusters, 47 Tuke is in the southern atmosphere. You could actually see it if you were in the southern hemisphere because it is naked. You can see it naked eye. It has a huge amount of stars. It used to be that we thought that globular cluster stars were, you know, kind of a dead end place because globular clusters are left behind in the halo when the galaxy collapsed into its sort of disk shape. So these are older stars left behind. But now we know that a lot of stellar evolution takes place within globular clusters. Tuke 47 is full of a bunch of exotic binary black hole X-ray binaries. NGC 1846 is a very interesting globular cluster. That one is actually in the Small Magellanic Cloud, and it actually contains a planetary nebula. They are now leaning towards it being actually part of the globular cluster and not just an accidental lineup between here and there. And there is such a different range in age disparity in this cluster, but they have about the same metallicity that this is thought to be two globular clusters that coalesce together to form one larger globular cluster.